Hello students, good morning. We were discussing the chapter thermodynamics and today we are moving to a new topic, that is heat capacity. Our topic is heat capacity. So first of all, we have to understand what does the term heat capacity mean. That is, you know, for raising the temperature, suppose if a substance has a temperature T1 and we have to raise the temperature T1 from its initial value to T2. Okay, so what we have to give? Yes, we have to supply a fixed amount of heat, isn't it? So if an amount of heat, let the heat be delta Q. Okay, delta Q amount of heat is needed to change its temperature by delta T. Delta T, you know, change in temperature, that is from from T1 to T2, means change T2 minus T1. Understand? Also, a small amount of heat is supplied, that is why delta Q. Then you can define this heat capacity as S is equal to delta Q by delta T. Understand? So how can you express it, or how can you define it numerically? As it is equal to the heat energy required to change the temperature of a body by unity. Okay, if I want to change the temperature of a body from 27 degrees Celsius to 28 degrees Celsius, that is 1 degree Celsius difference, that is a change in temperature. For that, how much amount of heat I supplied to that system? Understood? So that ratio is given by the heat capacity. So once again, heat capacity means it is equal to the heat energy required to change the temperature of a body by unity. Understood? The heat energy required to change the temperature of a body by unity. So what about the unit of heat capacity? You know, it is heat, it is a form of energy, so its unit will be in joules, right? And the unit of temperature is Kelvin, SI unit is Kelvin. So joule per Kelvin is the unit of heat capacity. Understood? Now we will discuss specific heat capacity. So, specific heat capacity means it is the amount of heat required to change the temperature of a substance by unity. Okay, here you are mentioning unit mass also. So, heat capacity, as you know, S is equal to delta Q by delta T. And here you have to include unit mass of the substance, which means that in this equation, I have to divide, that is small s is equal to this value divided by the mass of the substance, unit mass. So here also I will include 1 by m. So this is the expression for specific heat capacity, small s is equal to 1 by m into delta Q by delta T. Clear? So this small s is the specific heat capacity. Okay, m is the mass of the substance, delta Q, as you know, it is the heat supplied to the system, and delta T means the change in temperature. Now what about the unit here? Here you know it is joule per mass is kilogram. Okay, and what about temperature? Temperature is Kelvin. So joule per kilogram into Kelvin, or you can say joule kilogram raised to minus 1, Kelvin raised to minus 1. This is the SI unit of specific heat capacity. Understood? That is heat capacity per kilogram. Heat capacity per unit mass. Heat capacity per unit mass or per kilogram is known as specific heat capacity. Understood? And this specific heat capacity depends upon nature of the substance. Nature of the substance and also the temperature. Understood? Specific heat capacity depends upon nature of the substance and temperature. Okay. Now the next one is molar specific heat. Molar specific heat capacity in which you are expressing the specific heat in terms of unit mole. Okay, molar heat capacity means heat capacity per mole. So in the expression it will go like, it is denoted as C. C is equal to S divided by mu. S divided by mu. Here mu is the number of moles. So what about the expression S? 1 by mu into delta Q by delta T. 1 by mu into delta Q by delta T. And how can you define this molar specific heat? It is the amount of heat required. Amount of heat required to raise the temperature. Temperature of 1 gram mole of a substance through 1 unit or a unit. Understood? And what about the unit here? It is joule per mole Kelvin, or joule mole raised to minus 1, Kelvin raised to minus 1. Understood? This C also depends upon nature of substance, then its temperature and conditions under which heat is supplied. So you can say the C depends upon nature of the substance, then temperature and conditions. Conditions under which heat is supplied. Clear for you? So first we discussed heat capacity, then specific heat capacity, and then finally molar specific heat. Okay, clear with the equations and the units. Okay, so next we'll move to the another topic, that is specific heat capacities of gases. Now for gases, the specific heat capacity depends on the process or the conditions under which the heat exchange takes place between them, and means the system and the surroundings is taking place. Understood? Okay, that is this, for in the case of gases, you can say that the specific heat capacities depends on the process. Okay, the process or under which condition, this heat exchange takes place between the system and surroundings. Clear? And there are two main specific heat capacities for a gas, very important. The first one is the molar heat capacity at constant volume. Okay, at constant volume, which can be represented as CV, molar heat capacity at constant volume. And the second one is molar heat capacity at constant pressure, denoted as CP. Understood? CV and CP. C is used to denote the molar specific heat capacity, and if it is CV, which means that the volume is kept constant there. And molar heat capacity at constant pressure means the pressure is kept constant in this case. Okay, now how can you define this CV? CV, you can define, or the molar heat capacity at constant volume, you can define it as the amount of heat required to increase the temperature of one mole of a gas by 1 degree Celsius, or you can say 1 Kelvin. Okay, temperature change. And the condition is the oleum is kept constant, so that is at constant oleum is known as what? Molar heat capacity at constant oleum and denoted as CV. Okay, very important. Now the second one is molar heat capacity at constant pressure, that you can define as the amount of the same thing, only one change, that is kept at constant pressure, the amount of heat required to increase the temperature of 1 mole of a gas by 1 degree Celsius, or it can be 1 Kelvin, okay, at constant pressure. Clear? And it is denoted as what? Cp. Understood? Now there is a relation between this Cp and Cv, very very important, and that relation is known as Mayer's formula. So you have to study the relation between them by deriving the expression. Understood? Now we will move to that derivation, that is Mayer's formula. Mayer's formula means what? It is the relationship between this Cp and Cv. Okay, so in Mayer's equation, we already studied so many equations like for specific heat capacity in our last chapter also, isn't it? Thermal properties also, we have studied the specific heat capacity, then molar specific heat capacity, etc. And the expression goes like this. The Mayer's formula is Cp minus Cv is equal to R. Cp minus Cv equals R, where R, you know, it is a universal gas constant. Okay, so the difference between Cp and Cv is equal to the universal gas constant R. That is a relation that we have to derive. And for this, first we are taking the first law of thermodynamics. You all know the first law, equation for first law of thermodynamics. What is the equation? As it is delta Q is equal to delta U plus P delta V, isn't it? Where delta Q is the amount of heat supplied to a system, then delta U is the internal energy change, then P delta V is actually the work done, where P is the pressure and delta V is the change in oleum. Understood? Now, if suppose delta Q is absorbed, delta Q heat is absorbed at constant oleum, how can you write this expression? How will this expression change? That is, if delta Q is absorbed at constant oleum, this term, that is P delta V, here if it is constant oleum means change is zero, isn't it? So this delta Q by delta T at constant oleum is actually equal to delta U by delta T at constant oleum, isn't it? So actually this is what? This is Cb. We just studied, that is the amount of heat required to increase the temperature of 1 mole of a gas by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius at constant oleum. This V indicates that here the oleum is taken constant. Since the oleum is taken constant, in this expression delta V tends to 0, and so this equation is Cv, which is delta Q by delta T at constant oleum, which is equal to delta U by delta T at constant oleum. Understood? So this I can write it as delta U by delta T. Why I dropped this subscript V here? Can you think? As we have studied that the internal energy of an ideal, this is internal energy, right? Internal energy depends only on temperature. It doesn't depend upon the oleum. So you can drop this term and you can write it as Cv is equal to delta U by delta T. Okay, so this is the condition where heat is absorbed at constant oleum, isn't it? Now suppose the heat is absorbed at constant pressure. How does our first law of thermodynamics, this equation, change? So let us consider this case where heat is absorbed at constant pressure. Okay, that is, you know, delta Q is equal to, you have studied this equation earlier, Cp into delta T, isn't it? That is, Cp is equal to delta Q by delta T at constant pressure. Clear for you? Now, if I apply this equation in this particular first law of thermodynamics, how does it change? Yes, that is Cp, which is equal to delta Q by delta T at constant P, which is equal to, here I have to apply delta U by delta T at constant pressure, isn't it? And here we cannot put this delta V equals 0 because this is the heat applied or supplied at constant pressure. So I have to change this term, that is P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure. Clear? This is the expression. Here, in this term, I can drop the letter P because, as I told, internal energy depends only on temperature. It doesn't depend upon oleum or pressure or anything. So this expression will change to Cp Cp, okay, which is equal to delta U by delta T, I dropped this letter P, okay, plus P into delta V by delta T, sorry, delta P, okay, with respect to pressure we are doing, delta T, okay, at P, okay. So, what is this delta U by delta T? We already derived this expression where delta U by delta T is equal to Cv, isn't it? So, I can put here Cv plus P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure. We cannot cancel this, okay? This is a subscript only. So, P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure. This much clear? Now, we are considering or we are explaining the case of ideal gas. So, for ideal gas, you know, for 1 mole of ideal gas, you have studied the ideal gas equation, which is PV equals RT. Or you can say P into, if I differentiate this, delta V by delta T at constant pressure is equal to R. Okay, P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure is equal to R. Clear for you? So in this expression, instead of P into delta V by delta T at constant P, I can put R. Clear? That is, Cp is equal to Cv plus R, or you can say Cp minus Cv is equal to R. Okay, here Cp and Cv are the molar specific heat capacities of an ideal gas at constant pressure and oleum respectively, and R is the universal gas constant. Understood? And also the ratio of Cp and Cv, you have to know this. Cp by Cv is given by a ratio which is gamma. Cp by Cv is equal to gamma. Clear? So that's all about Mayer's equation. So this is very simple. First understand the concept of Cp and Cv, then the relation is Cp minus Cv equals R. For that we are taking the first law of thermodynamics, that is delta Q equals delta U plus P delta V. Okay, now first of all we are applying the heat or supplying the heats to the system at constant volume. So each term I have to represent it at constant volume. So we have studied this expression, that is delta Q is equal to Cv into delta T. You have studied earlier, and here Cv equals delta Q by delta T at constant volume. Again, each term I have to represent it at constant volume. At that time, this term P delta V will tend to zero, as it is at constant volume. There is no change, that is delta V is equal zero. So Cv is equal to delta U by delta T only remains. Okay, similarly, if I apply the heat at constant pressure, this will change to Cp, that is delta Q by delta T at constant P. Again, putting the subscript as delta U by delta T at constant P is again P into delta V by delta T at constant P. Understood? Actually, the expression is P into delta V by delta T plus delta V into delta P by delta T. This expression comes. This is actually you are studying in mathematics as differentiation, that is product rule. Two terms, first one into differential of second plus second into differential of first. In this case, since it is delta P, the change is equal to zero, this term only exists. That is why I put like this, P into delta V by delta T in that constant pressure. Okay, now what will happen here? Cp equal to delta U by delta T. I dropped the subscript P because again internal energy depends only upon temperature. So delta U by delta T plus P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure. Okay, now for ideal gas equation, PV equals RT, and again if you are differentiating this particular expression with respect to temperature, you will get P into delta V by delta T at constant pressure is equal to R. Clear for you? Now substituting the value here, I can write or I can change this expression as Cp equals Cv plus R, where Cp and Cv are the molar specific heat capacities at constant pressure and constant volume, and R is the universal gas constant. Clear for you? Okay.